on the block, the dual mobility may again change this thing completely now, and we may be offering a dual mobility in some of these hemiarthroplasty patients too. So what implant to use? Once we've decided we are going to do a hemi or a total hip, we need to decide what kind of implant are we going to put. So here the level of osteoporosis guides us what we are going to do, and the calcar femoral ratio helps us, and the DOR classification, wherein the type A is where you have a champagne flute kind of a hip, where an uncemented do very well because there is good bone stock. If you have a normal kind of hip, there is some amount of osteoporosis. We can use either of the two depending on what you prefer. But if there is osteoporosis and there is wide canal and there is stove type pipe kind of a canal, then I think the cemented implant would always do better because of porosis. You may not get good outcome with uncemented. So cemented hip replacements have given very good results in fracture in femur, especially where there is osteoporosis and there is less periprosthetic fractures in the cemented hip, and also there is improved postoperative outcome as regards to residual thigh pain and mobility. So cemented hip scores over uncemented in fracture in femur, especially with porosis. So if today I have an active patient who has a good bone stock and wants to be really active, then I would do an uncemented purely because it offers me a better bearing surface. And sometimes I may even offer a hybrid hip, because even a hybrid hip can give me a same bearing like a ceramic on ceramic or ceramic on poly, which we know now has definitely better wear rates, and longevity will also be better. But most of us, when we have a fractured femur, are faced with this kind of a situation where there's an old patient, where there's porosis, patient is less active. And I do not think there is any other option but to do a cemented stem. And depending on what the level of activities, we may put a bipolar or a total hip in these kind of patients. The main reason why cemented hips or cemented stems are going out of vogue is because of the fear of failure that a lot of surgeons have seen. But the uncemented hip also fails. And now, after analyzing these failures, we can come to a conclusion that the main reason for the failure was poor quality poly, which led to poly wear and loosening, and also poor cement mantle, which led to early loosening because of the debris going into the femoral canal and causing to loosening of the implant. The second reason why people are avoiding to do cemented hip is this fear of complication, where some of us have seen intraoperatively there is this bone cement implantation syndrome, which leads to hypotension, hypoxia, etc. And there is sometimes lack of confidence in one cementing technique. So what is bone cement implantation syndrome? So this is a scenario characterized by hypoxia, hypotension, and loss of consciousness that you see while cementing a stem inside or a prosthesis inside, which can sometimes lead to cardiac arrhythmias and cardiac arrest. So this is what people today fear about, and that is the main reason why people are not using cemented hip. But that is actually not true. The risk is not that. Still cement my literature. There is techniques have improved and the results are definitely better. And again, the technique is not so difficult to learn or do or teach, and hence we should not fear the cementing technique. It's definitely cost effective because there are cheaper hips, and definitely it also leads to helps us recon stress protection, and hence there is no stress shielding, and they can always be revised easily, more better than the uncemented hip. So why would if you see a cemented system like an Exeter system, for every canal size you'll have multiple offsets, multiple stem lengths, and multiple neck lengths. That would help me to reconstruct my femoral geometry very accurately, and I can really give a patient a accurate hip or a hip which looks and feels like the opposite hip, and there is no limb-length discrepancy postoperatively. Again, the second thing that we fear is in a porotic bone, if you try to really shove in a thick uncemented implant, we can end up with these kind of periprosthetic fractures, which if you go through the literature, are common in while doing an uncemented hip. And one of the reasons why revision is required after an uncemented hip replacement in fracture in femur. What do we do when the patient is a very small patient? Sometimes we get patients which are less than 5 feet 3 inches and all that. The sizes are very small. So there is no option but to use a cemented hip because those come in small sizes. again, most of us who revise hips will agree with me that revising a cemented hip is much easier than revising an uncemented, well-grown, uncemented hip. Again, economic reasons, last but not least, the economic reasons also play a role. For the same choice of bearing, the cemented hip is almost 40 to 50% cheaper as compared to an uncemented hip. So I would still go ahead and cement most of my hips unless the patient is really active and needs a better bearing surface. And I feel budding orthopedic surgeons need to learn and perfect the cemented technique. It is not very scared of this and should perfect your technique so that you can easily do a cemented hip with hardly any risk of any complications or any fear. So let's study the main fear that we have. That is called bone cement implantation syndrome. It is characterized by hypoxia, hypotension, and loss of consciousness that we get when we are cementing a hip inside, which can sometimes lead to cardiac arrhythmias and cardiac arrest. Now, it can happen during any cemented arthroplasty, but to a small extent, it can also happen during uncemented arthroplasty when we are opening or reaming the canal or when we are introducing the stem or sometimes when we are reducing the hip. So not that it does not happen at all in an uncemented hip, it also can happen in an uncemented hip. So to a small extent or to some extent, it happens in about 15 to 30% of all the cemented procedures. What it may be any procedure in your body, but it can happen in about 15 to 30% of procedures. But out of all these, the severe variety is only seen in 3 to 8%. But when you have a serious severe variety, you can have a mortality rate of about 0.22%. And there's also associated high 30-day and one-year mortality rate with the severe type of cement implantation syndrome, as shown by multiple series in the literature. So what is the cause of this cement implantation syndrome? Initially, it was thought monobur was the main reason, but studies have shown that the amount of monobur in circulation is not that much to cause all the reaction. I feel embolization is the main reason why it happens. And when we are cementing a hip or putting an implant inside in the stem, there is high intramedullary pressure, and which can then lead to embolization of the debris in the canal, which consists of fat, marrow, cement particles, air, bone particles, and sometimes aggregates of platelets and fibrin. These embolus can then go and lodge into the lungs, the brain, or the cerebral circulation, or the coronary circulation, and then they can cause a reaction. Mechanically, they can stimulate the endothelium, leading to vasoconstriction, or into the pulmonary circulation, they can, the vasoactive and the pro-inflammatory substances can lead to increased pulmonary vascular resistance, or into the peripheral system, it can lead to a reduced systemic vascular resistance, leading to hypotension and hypoxia. Also, there are high levels of histamine that are observed in patients who have hypotension, and some also increased levels of C3a and C5a are been seen in patients with vasoconstriction, bronchoconstriction. So I feel all the different mechanisms play a role, and it's a combination of all these processes, and the clinical outcome will depend on what is the patient's physiological response to this and what are his reserves like. So initially there is increased pulmonary vascular resistance, which leads to right ventricular ejection, reduction in right ventricular ejection fraction. The compliant right ventricular thin wall, right ventricle then distends, and it then bulges the inter ventricular septum into the left ventricle, which further reduces the left ventricular filling as well as the cardiac output. Now the bones BCIS has been graded by Donaldson et al. And the commonest type is the grade 1, where 90% of the patients, this is what occurs, where the SpO2 doesn't fall below 94%. Neither does the systolic blood pressure fall below 20%. The grade 2 or the severe type is where the SpO2 falls up to 88%, and there is almost 40% drop in the systolic blood pressure, and you can have unexpected loss of consciousness in these. And the severe type, the cardiovascular collapse requiring CPR, is sometimes seen rarely. So how can we manage, or how can we avoid this? The most important part of avoiding PCIS is, first, we have to anticipate when it can happen, then we need to diagnose or detect it early, and then manage it aggressively. So it can happen, we have to identify the risk factors before we take up the patient. So any patient with ASA class type 3 or 4, any old patient more than 75 years of age, It is seen more in males than in females. Any patient who has a pre-existing pulmonary hypertension, COPD, severe pulmonary fibrosis, or renal disease leading to raised serum creatinine are at higher risk. Osteoporosis, bony metastasis, and presence of pathological fractures are also associated with higher chances of BCIS. Revision surgery, there is a higher incidence. Again, if you're operating on a patient femur which is not had been instrumented before, or there's a long prosthesis you are planning, longer stem prosthesis you are planning, there is a higher chance. And again, patients who are on diuretics or warfarin, again, have been found to have a higher incidence of BCIS. So the most important thing is to recognize these patients with high risk factors. Once you have this kind of a patient, we need to discuss it with our team. We should comprise of the surgeon, the anesthetist team, and the intensivist. And we need to try and optimize our patient's comorbidities before we take up the patient for surgery. And we need to discuss exactly what kind of roles each of us are going to play during the surgery and in the perioperative period. So what are the BCIS can occur during a hip replacement during 5 steps. First, when we open the femoral canal. Secondly, when we introduce cement into the acetabulum or the femoral canal. Then we insert the prosthesis. That is the time it can happen. And lastly, when we reduce the hip, again, because of sudden reopening of the femoral vein, we can again have embolism and BCIS occurring. So it has been found in literature that the best anesthesia in a high-risk patient to avoid BCIS is a low-dose spinal weight epidural with preferably no sedation, so that the patient is active and we come to know if the patient gets disoriented or is not behaving properly. Best is to avoid volatile anesthetic agents and nitrous oxide. So GA should be avoided as much as possible. And most of the centers world over form a curfew or a form of standard protocol where everything is discussed as to what role every team member is going to play in case of some serious BCIS occurring. So on the anesthesia side, once we've taken the patient up and we are about ready to cement, they need to be very vigilant and monitor the blood pressure, the PO2 and ETCO2 every 2 minutes with accuracy and extra vigilance. CVP needs to be monitored and fluid needs to be replaced if required. They need to be aware of dyspnea, delirium, or loss of consciousness, because sometimes it's only delirium or loss of altered consciousness which is the first sign, or the fall in ETCO2 is the first sign. So they have to be aware and they need to be prepared for a severe reaction and be ready for a CPR if needed. Before cementing, the anesthesia team is told to replace the fluid if required with accurate CVP monitoring, and the team should try and achieve blood pressure which is within 20% of the pre-existing or pre-surgery BP levels. They should start oxygenating the patient to avoid hypoxia, drugs like corticosteroid and as possible, plug the canal, and always use a vent wherever you're going to introduce the cement or we're going to introduce any hydrogen peroxide, etc., because venting does reduce the chance of embolism. Before you start cementing, inform your team that you're going to start mixing the cement. Use a low viscosity cement, which is known to be associated with lesser chance of BCIS. Vacuum mixing definitely reduces the monomer, that vapors that the patient can inhale or can have, and definitely reduces the risk. Retrograde cementing using a cement gun and using a vent definitely after your cement is applied to the bone. So after you've done a cementing and introduce the implant, remember, the next 20 minutes are very, very critical, and the team should be ready to resuscitate if there is any severe reaction. And remember, this altered pulmonary state remains for 24 to 48 hours. So if you have a severe reaction, the patient definitely needs to go to an ICU. So if you have some hypotension on table or there is hypoxia, keep this patient without any hesitation into the ICU for next 48 hours so that their altered cardiopulmonary state can be well dealt with. So the best way to manage BCIS and avoid mortality is to anticipate by identifying the high-risk patients, detect it early, and make your team very aware and treat this very, very aggressively so that you don't have the severe reactions and we don't need to have a patient who has a collapse and you need to revive that patient or something. So once we decide to cement a hip, discuss with your patient, optimize, and don't be really scared of this. If you take few careful steps in during your surgery, you can really avoid the severe kind of BCIS. So once you decided to cement, what are the cemented options that we have? So today we have two types of cemented stems that are available in the market, the composite beam type and a taper slip type. The composite beam type is where there is a collar, there's a rough finish, and there are flanges or grooves so as to form a strong bond between the bone cement and the stem. Typically in our market, the Muller or the Lubina stem is example of this. This is very popular in Europe, not so popular elsewhere. Here, because of the strong bond, the stresses are passed directly from the stem onto the shaft of the femur, and there is bypass of the proximal femur, which can lead to stress shielding of the proximal femur and calcar reception. And again, the cement bond has to be very good here. So the cementing technique needs to be very good, and it is not forgiving. So the commonest stem that is used world over is the taper slip type, which consists of a collarless, polished, and a double or a triple taper kind of stem. Typically, the Exeter CPT or the C stem in our market are examples of these. Here the stem is supposed to subside initially, leading to radial compressive forces, stress the proximal bone. The specially designed centralizers helps us to achieve this subsidence. Once the stem subsides, then the hoof stresses are generated in the proximal femur, which leads to nice stress transfer onto the proximal femur, and there is no stress shielding of the proximal femur. Here, the cementing technique need not be perfect, and this is a bit forgiving. So, even with poor cementing techniques, this works very well. So, this is what is done very popularly all over the world. Now, the cement, once you select an implant, remember this, the type of the cement is, the stem is very important. Today in our market, there are multiple lookalikes. Be careful. The stem needs to be made up of stainless steel or which is nitrogenized or chromium cobalt. I typically use the Exeter system wherein for each and every canal die size, we have multiple lengths, offsets and necklets available so that you can really reconstruct the proximal geometry very nicely. And plus with the stem, you can literally put whatever kind of bearing or cup or bipolar, whatever is required. So you can go from bipolar to a cemented hip to an uncemented, to an hybrid kind of a hip using a ceramic bearing if you need to. So my commonest choice is the Exeter system, which helps me accurately reconstruct my femoral geometry, which leads to very good reconstruction of femoral geometry, leading to good good hip function and good accurate limb length correction. So here, beware of the copies that are there in the market. The implant guys will come and tell you the XYZ implant is doing well, and I have an implant which is absolute copy of that. So beware of these copies. Use a system with good track record and good registered data, and you will have good results. So once you've selected an implant and you have selected your processes that you're going to use, then comes the main procedure. Here, the newer femoral retractors helps us to achieve good exposure with a smaller and smaller approach. So you can really have a small incision and have a good femoral exposure. Once you expose the femur, then next is the osteotomy. Typically, we do an osteotomy at about 1.5 to 2 centimeters in the lesser trochanter. Because we are using a collarless implant, exact level of osteotomy is not very critical. And here now you need to identify the piriform fossa, because the entry needs to be made there so that you avoid malpositioning or malalignment of the implant. And you start opening your canal here. Once you open the canal, then the next, I feel, is the most important step. Here, you have to take your time and do a good copious lavage using 1 to 2 liters of fluid. Wash out all the debris. Here, if possible, pulse lavage system really helps. But if you don't have pulse lavage system, use a normal low pressure lavage system. But lavage the canal to such an extent that you're completely happy and you have a nice bone, dry looking canal that you see, and there's no blood seeping out of that. I feel this is the most important step in my preparation. Once that is achieved, then you remove the overhanging medial part of the greater trochanter using a box chisel, and then you can use a lateralizer so that you make a good entry which is a lateral, and you don't end up putting your implant in varus. At the end of your preparation, you should end up having cancellous bone on the anterior tells you that your entry of the stem and not touch the posterior cortex. So once that is done, then you keep on you reach the templated size that you reached, put a head onto and see if you have reconstructed your offsets to your pre-op. Note that there will be marks onto the marks that matched brooch, which are also the association of these marks onto that you have on the proximal femur, so that you can final implant it. Once that is done, then you so that you don't need to really go beyond. So initially we used to use this. Today we should use a modern acrylate, which then a uniform mantle side, so a symmetric, and then you can pack. If there is bleeding, you can pack with, but remember you need to use medical grade and be aware of what kind of hydrogen peroxide is available in the operation theater. Many times if there is the bleeding is not very profuse, then I would rather pack it with just a dry pack rather than putting a hydrogen peroxide, but I will always vent the canal, because again venting definitely reduces. If possible, I'll use vacuum mixing system so that there is definitely a uniform mantle which is formed and there is less chance of bone over getting into the patient's circulation. Then I'll use a cement gun with a proximal seal and nicely fill the cement in a retrograde fashion using a proximal femoral seal to pressurize it using the system. Once I've used my gun, then I would do digital pressurization, especially in zone 1 and 7, because invariably you'll see in zone 1 and 7, there is deficient cement seen, especially zone 1 laterally. So use your little fingers and your thumbs to try and get cement into that lateral trochanteric region, because invariably you'll see there is not enough cement in that region. Once you've done that, then you gently introduce your cement templated stem till your templated level. So these marks on the stem that you normally get, so you introduce it till the level that you have seen with your trial brooch. Then once you introduce your stem to the desired level, then use a cement, then use just a holder and to maintain it at that level, because when the cement expands, cures, then it can expand and you can get your cement, the implant to come out by a millimeter or two. So maintain gentle, sustained pressure to maintain the implant at that level. And once the cement sets in, again, check your offsets by putting a trial head, then reduce your hip very, very gently, as I told you, because again, this is the time when you can have embolism that can occur. And again, check your limb length correction and check your stability. Once you are happy with the head that you selected or the neck length that you selected, take in a final head and do a final reduction. So if you are careful, you select the implant well, take care of some steps intraoperatively, you can safely do a cemented hip, which looks good, which gives you good, very definitely gives you good function, and there is no problem of any intraoperative mortality or any untoward incidents that can happen. So this is what I normally do. This is how I cement my hips. And I would say in a fracture neck femur, almost 90% of the times I would end up doing a cemented stem, a bipolar or a cemented total hip, and uncemented purely again for the bearing that they offer, not so much with the stem. Okay. Thank you for patient hearing. I feel we may take questions later on.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Atul, for a lovely expose. And I know that you are a great cementer, if I may say so, which some of us have a little doubts. I hope they are cleared by this. Can I now call upon Dr. Vivek Shetty to please share his screen to enlighten us about how the new kid on the block, the dual mobility, is faring and how much we can hope to achieve by it. Vivek, all yours.
Thank you, Girish. Thank you for the invite. Great presentation, Atul. So my brief is to talk on the dual mobility total hip replacement. Is my screen seen and am I audible?
Yes, Vivek. All okay. Good.
Yeah. Okay. So is that the right choice in fraction neck femurs? So that's my kind of my experience that I'd like to share. These are my disclosures. Has no bearing on the presentations. So what I'd like to discuss is my indication in fraction neck of femurs. What is the role of bipolar, if there is any now, total hip replacement, and the dual mobility, which is the main thrust of my talk. We look at the morbidity and mortality in bipolar and THR, and what are the functional outcomes? Is the dual mobility any better than the bipolar versus THR? Do we require a different skill set while you're doing the dual mobility, or if you are a regular arthroplasty surgeon, you can kind of continue to move on to doing dual mobility? Are all dual mobility total hip replacements implants the same? And what are my concerns in the present dual mobility scenario? So I'd like to cover all of these in my presentation. So I went back to my archives of my cases in 2012. If this was my theater board, when we do our timeouts. So this was a lady, Parkinson's, with an unsteady gait, diabetic, and had a domestic fall. And you can see, like how Atul mentioned, I have this plan to use a CPT cemented stem. So if you can see, the hip is a bit of a varus, and I wanted a little more horizontal offset. At that time, this was my treatment, a bipolar hip arthroplasty cemented. And she did pretty well. No problems on that front. Come 2016, similar age group for a lady who has had a second hip fracture, and she's mentally alert and diabetic. And in this case, I opted to, just like how previously suggested, a cemented CPT that was used. Choice. So what has happened in the last 4 years? Are these different patients, or have my views on how the fracture is to be fixed changed? So when you generally look at it, when you look at these patients who are so-called elderly, so patients who are above the age of 65, they might be, or 70 for that matter, people might generally say, okay, I would rather do a hemi arthroplasty. Generally, people would opt for that. Very few might take on the doing a total hip replacement if they are cognitive functions all there and they follow the post-op regime. And what is the role of dual mobility THR is what I'm opting for now. Now, if you have a younger set of patients who are high demanding and who are physically very active with good bone quality, if you don't opt for an internal fixation for whatever reasons, do your choices remain still the same? Or do you go for a total hip now versus a dual mobility THR? So that's the recommendations that is going around the literature right now. So then you look at these fractures in the elderly with comorbidities, medical comorbidities, you go for a bipolar is what we are thinking. And in a younger population who are physically active, total hip replacement. So who is an elderly patient? Somebody who's, you need to look at their mobility status. So I look at whether they were walking independently or using a stick. Did they have a balance issue? And do a mental test score. By that time, month of the year, the date, the prime minister, and so on. Some basic questions which most of them would answer. And if they are mentally alert, I know that I would be able to give a total hip replacement. At the present times, I will do a dual mobility in these cases. So I look at the porosity of the bone, then depending on that, I will do an uncemented or a cemented dual mobility. So in these elderly age group. So here's looking at a first case as to trying to kind of bipolar in the young men in 2016, a partial hip replacement. And in within getting pain And there was no infection signs. The Harris Hip score was 57.3. So this is a present, I'd say, a decently done cemented bipolar replacement. And the only thing that I could think about, it's very early for acetabulary, had ended a total the patient's Harris Hip score. And there, other than ruling out that the acetabular erosion, too early for that, did happen. So when you compare a total hip replacement versus a hemiarthroplasty in fraction acre femur, and this is a very large series, and you will get conflicting report in these large series, they talked about the total hip replacement was associated with a lower risk of reoperation, the higher hip HR group, and the down, then there is a higher rate of dislocation. The trade-off surgery because of acetabular wear dislocation. Hip patient had a lower reoperation rate. Belief that a hemiarthroplasty morbidity and not really so. Another paper, how do you improve the looking at the data, see if you can pay it, look at the femoral head size, total hip increase the rate. Let everybody suggesting a functional result and let another the NHS in England large series of hemiarthroplasty group, cemented hemiarthroplasty. Now they looked at a very large series, 3,800 odd cases versus 41,000. And if you look at it generally the world over, if it's somebody under the age of 65, then more people opt for a total hip replacement. Somewhere between 65 and 74 age group, again, a larger group, 30% of people would go for a. If somebody is really older, then the hemiarthroplasty comes on its own. Now, this was the number from then NHS. What they did was try to get the patient age match so then they could do a apple to apple comparison. So in this case, a THR versus a hemiarthroplasty, and looked at what their complications were. And as expected, the dislocation rate was higher in the THR group when they were matched with the hemiarthroplasty group. The revision rate was also 1.54% versus 0.7 in the hemiarthroplasty. Now, this is, apologize, on the unmatched group. When you go to the matched group, suddenly the THR looks like the dislocation rate is still the same, higher in the total hip replacement group. The revision rate is almost similar in the age match group. So the group, they suggested that there is not much difference when you age match them and use all the comparison and do a similar comparison. There is not much difference between the arthroplasty group. Again, a large number of comparison in the last series, they looked at the review the health questionnaire, mortality, dislocative time. Other than the operation, the hemiarthroplasty group matched the in as well as the revision. Then these guidelines, the National Institute for Health, if a patient fit cognitively, not to undergo the surgery, then total hip replacement is a choice to be made. So the evidence here, and clearly orthopedic surgeon and his skill set and his patients, total hip replacement on a hemiarthroplasty. The problem of dislocation and revision rate, full mobility may be a game changer. So 2016 as somebody who's had a hip revised in May of 2018 dislocations. Patient has been bedridden, no sign of open cup, so I'm not making a justification. Badly done surgery, whether it's a hemi arthroplasty or a kind of improve on your skill sets there. The picture, I had to revise that for me to get the implant out. A cemented dual mobility THR and a good Harris hip score after a revision surgery. The prosthesis has migrated 6 years. When you do a hemi arthroplasty, they don't case 6 years down the line, the implant is, see, and the prosthesis has too far in. So what I did was retrocanteric osteotomy, did and that was at 6 weeks that she was walking okay, and that was her gait. She was pretty comfortable. 3 months picture, and she is now out. Another case where there is a bipolar done and problems there, revised on the acetabular side. So dislocation rate was traction neck of femur, what is the evidence? Again, series where they looked at 380 patients, hemi total hip replacement, and compared the hemi arthroplasty for, but for dislocation and the rate for revision hemi arthroplasty have a IE reading dual mobility to total hip to go forward. So it addresses the problem of this less revision. So for doing a dual mobility TAS in the because of the wear and tear seen. So the recommendation is as I suggest, dual mobility, do you still have a role to play wanting to do bipolar? I'm kind of saying that. So credit to be given to this the start of the back to the 1970 long-term data have to be credited to the French survival data and the bearing surfaces, the outer poly, and you have the option of the benefit of the dual bearings. So the conventional versus the dual mobility. Now, this is my, so was very young, but otherwise physically very active. Paralysis of his, has had to kind of went replacement and is him walking with his caliper back to work. So 60-year-old again with no medical comb. That's the picture at extremely well, following a dual atom replacement, and that's a gait at 1 year. This I give them as per our customs, if that's what they. Is there any data versus of THR comparing to dual mobility TH neck of femur. So this was a French comparative data of their primary total hip repair, comparing it with dual mobility for all. And it was interesting to see that dislocation rate really went down in a primary compared to the Chanley type total hip replacement to use in a primary scenario. Dual THR versus hemiarthroplasty, another plasty and dual mobility with a minimum follow-up years. The two groups had 96 patients. Conclusion at 3 years was that equally well to surprise to, they recommend both the dual mobility and hemiarthroplasty over the others. And my concern, 55 to 65, the hemiarthroplasty, then the, what about my experience, our data from our hospital, dual mobility team in the elderly group, and we published this in last year. That's the large percentage of this group were, and I'm quite happy to say that there's none of them had a dislocation, not one, and they have published THR versus conventional total hip replacement, given to one of our postgraduate, Samay Kataria, and he did a very fantastic job on prospectively looking at the two groups and looked at their as they Harris, no dislocation in either of the group, was far superior, significantly superior. This is a short study, but the was Harris hip scope far better in the dual mobility THR group. So any concern that I have, sure, I do have my concern. Any corrosions when there is about modular dual mobility is another problem. At a later date, or maybe even at a very dislocation, more when there is the neck impingement. This is a paper that came in a case report, the dislocation secondary to that metal ion level. Concerns these levels for modular dual mobility in, still want to have screws in there. They would need a liner. The liner could be either metal. They may have traction as well in them. Only thing where it kind of lead to the wear around, leading to a, might be at a later stage. Problems. This is a paper from New York. A series of cases, and they talk 2.9, something which is a bit of a concern. In more, the dual mobility dislocation rate is around 4. What about switching over to cross-link poly? Will that be a, we don't know the answer for that. Impingement, just switching over to and taking the highly cross-linked poly and thinking that there might be less wear may not be. Not all types of dual them ones and the modular ones. So, come needs to analyzed most of the data that is there are the standard dual mobility data, which has come out from France, and they talk about long-term survival. And this is one paper from France, which talked about a 22 to 25-year-old survival and the dislocation rate. Remember, this is a 22-millimeter head and the old plastic. And the interprosthetic dislocation rate was 4.1%. Again, this is for all comers and not just for fracture neck. And at 22 to 25 years, the survival, which is for the tribology, which was there in the 70s. So my concern, dislocation, polywear at the outer bay, secondary to psoas impingement, and the way I address dual mobility cup in more antiversion that normal about the metal ion release, and this is more regular in the standard implant. If you don't have a proper seating, and there are cases where if the seating is erosion, femoral notching is still a problem. So addressed by the companies. To conclude, in the elderly age group, I have mobility in all. Say that one is, if you are in the elderly age group, maybe they'll 50% more elderly, so you may kind of argue for a hemi. I am kind of use if they have neuromuscular disorders or a part of dual mobility issues. For the fitter age group, I THR. I am worried about the long term. All remember. What about dual mobility? Are not proven yet, and we need to be concerned. Modular implants with wear and iron that is waiting. We need to get more highly cross-linked poly blindly. On a sobering note, and I'd like to thank.
Thank you. I, for one, I'm completely with you, and using dual mobility a little more often with care, ones which really merit psychological profile. And okay, so I'm going to share my screen. Okay, can you see this?
Can see your screen.
Okay. Talks challenges and one on the newer. I'm going to be speaking on something which we all promise, that if we have fixed the proximal, happens if it goes to peace, we get out of that. So that's why my topic is the in these failed situations. A picture will be purely clinical based without the hip fractures, as we all know, and in our population is ever increasing. This is due to increased longevity and osteoporosis, unstable fracture patterns, in cases which do fail reduction. Now the genesis of that is routine sometimes take the reduction for position. Yeah, now this is not a trauma talk, so I'm not going to this failed. We'll focus on what happens if for those who have been there not seem to be maybe we are facing a different more osteoporosis, resulting in more. This is time. See, luckily, of experienced surgeons, but we. It may be somebody else does come along. Now, all talk are the intracapsular fractures. They have been covered to some extent by Vivek. AVN, which occurs in situations post fracture fixation. So that these two groups are not a part of this presentation. So this is what we need to talk about. Fracture which ostensibly looks well reduced and well fixed with the DHS and the patient is allowed to mobilize, but at the end of 4 or 5 months down the line comes with increasing pain and restricted mobility, and this is what the x-ray shows. And all we have to do is to go back, remove all the hardware and subject it to some sort of arthroplasty. It could be bipolar in most cases where the acetabulum is well maintained, but in certain cases we may have to do a total hip if the acetabulum has been damaged. But then why arthroplasty? Why not refix it? My answer is why not? Because it simply does work. These are patients with advanced age. Our demands are to mobilize this patient early, and we need a definitive surgery. There is no way in this world that we want them to have a surgery where there's even a lingering small doubt that this may not succeed in the long term. So what are the options? Do we do a bipolar or do we do a total hip? And if we do a total hip, do we do a conventional durability as Vivek alluded to, or do we do a constrained liner? Now the decision of which of these three total hip types you do depends, in my humble opinion, is on the patient profile. If you have a patient who is demented, completely batty, unable to obey commands, then I personally go more down the line of semi-constrained, i.e. dual mobility or a constrained liner. If the patient otherwise well and himself or herself, then a conventional hip would do. A bipolar is my go-to option when the acetabulum is virgin. Importantly, you have to rule out infection in all these cases which have a failed fixation. My steps include dislocating the hip initially before removing the failed implant. Whichever approach you are familiar can be used. I tend to use an anterolateral approach or direct lateral in all my cases. But for those who are posterior approach surgeons, maybe they can consider the anterolateral if they have a stiff knee to boot as well. What are the challenges that we faced? First, of course, because of the failed primary fracture, there's altered bony anatomy. There is non-union, malunion of varying degrees at the initial fracture site. There is proximal bone loss. There are the holes from the previous implant to contend with, whether it's a four-hole DHS or a longer implant or a nail, whatever the case may be. Now, my feeling, and this is something which is borne out by a lot of literature as well, is that due to underlying porosis, the femoral neck cannot really tolerate more than one tract, and trying to make another tract increases the risk of cutout. So GIRF, which is getting it right the first time, is the mantra for all surgeries. And you'll be hearing this word a couple of times further in my presentation as well. So hip fractures in the elderly, we have to do the first time the best option so that they don't come back with the problem. Now, cemented revisions have been done, and appeared notwithstanding. I personally am not a great fan of these in the revision scenario, but in case those who are keen on doing it, they have to understand that you may not have trials for the long stems. You have to block the holes when cementing because pressurization of the cement column is not going to be possible with the holes uncovered. And bad cementing is equal to failure, as Atul clearly said in his talk as well. Modularity would be required to be adjusted, and it's difficult to contain the cement proximally as well. And secondly, but not the least, trochanteric healing may be absent because the presence of cement prevents bone healing in a proximal femoral scenario. Instrumental revisions is the go-to option. Cylindrical or tapered stem is my personal choice. Proximally coated stems, not their best because proximal bone is not very viable and sustainable to give predictable healing. Trochanters heal up well because there's no cement to intervene. Distal fixation with supplementary distal locking, if you have a fracture line which is going down more distally, can be an option. So at the end, my personal choice, an uncemented stem, distal fixing to get around the poor quality proximal bone stock and to get around the option of poor cement pressurization. THR, of course, as I mentioned earlier, if the acetabulum is violated and as per physiology. So all the criteria that you use for a THR in a neck femur should be applicable here as well. Immobility, I will not touch on. Vivek has done an excellent job. So this is now coming up as a treatment option and I personally am very excited by it. The single most important determinant of success is reconstruction of the abductor apparatus. It does not have to be a bony union, but there must be a continuity in the abductors. I personally started off using a wire suture, but have now moved on to number 5 Ethibond. Some people do prefer a fiber wire as well. All these three work well in as per surgeon preference. And mobilization has to be under supervision, which basically means that we have to go a little slow to allow the abductors second time to heal before we put them through their paces. So let's talk about some cases to illustrate the points that I've just discussed. This is a 76-year-old lady with a trochanteric fracture. Complex four-part intertrochanteric, if I may say so, has been fixed. But you can see the immediate post-op picture with a drain in situ that things don't seem to have gone the way they were planned. There is already a collapse on table and not much space left for further collapse. So I'm not, you won't be surprised if you saw this image at about, patient has started mobilizing. Then it goes on to this, where mobility stops, pain increases, and that's when she presented to us. And this is what I did. I did a distal fixing uncemented stem with a conventional total hip scenario, and the abductor mechanism was reconstructed using Ethibond sutures. And at 2 years post-op, you can see the trochanter has still maintained its position, and she was functioning well without any problems. Another scenario where a post-op X-ray gives you a clue as to what is going to happen next. And surprise, surprise, that this is exactly went the way it was expected to go. And this lady required another similar distal fixing hip replacement. This is the time when I used to do the cement, the wire usage for abductor reconstruction. But these are cases which have now been, as I said, replaced by Ethibond sutures. Another case, now in this you can argue that probably the choice of implant here was not absolutely appropriate. Bipolar hemi system, and you can see proximal bone heals around this distal fixing stem. There is porous coating of the stem in the proximal part which stimulates the bone healing. Now, do we think that nailing has solved all our problems? Yes, it has decreased them, but not completely solved them because a badly done nail is a badly done nail. So this is one patient who had a proximal femoral fracture fixed with an old design of the PFN, which failed probably because of severe porosis. And we had to go in and do a constrained hip in this lady because she was completely demented and unable to even comply with the basic instructions of not sitting cross-legged or sitting on the floor. Another patient who had a nail put in for a intertrochanteric fracture, which is not exactly conventional, I must admit, and no wonder it did not do well. And this was converted into a hemiarthroplasty because on table I found the acetabulum to be pretty good and not showing.
Obviously,
it is there. This is something which Vivek would identify with, and I'm admit I'm doing more of these now, dual mobility hip replacements in these cases, which have been done previously fixed with nails, which have failed, and then you convert them to a dual mobility total hip replacement. Cement, the stem, I must admit, I always use an uncemented variety. I've still not got around to accepting that a cemented long stem has any good role in revision hip scenario. Atul will bear me out whether a long stem revision cemented has any role with, because you really cannot pressurize a cement column as much as you would like. Another patient, 80-year-old, demented with Parkinsonism, nailing done, progressive failure as the fracture into varus. This, I suspect, was because of poor reduction, and the nail finally cut through, presented to us at that juncture, and we converted it into a constrained total hip replacement using an uncemented Wagner type of stem to prevent any further evidence of instability and one-stop shop for. What about reverse intertrox and high subprocanteric fractures? These fractures are important to analyze and decide exactly which implant to use. With intermedullary and cephalomedullary nailing, things have become a little easier, but the DCS was never a great option, which I will just show you. DCS, even by the AO standard, is only recommended for stable fracture patterns, as it does not allow controlled collapse and compression, with a higher chance of failure. So, the same philosophy, depending on the age and the acetabulum, we decide whether a hemiarthroplasty or a total hip arthroplasty is indicated. Total hip arthroplasty is also something which we go for if the patient is physiologically well and has higher functional demands. So, the same situation, get it right the first time, do not violate the femoral neck again. It's not going to hold more. You've already made one track, so don't try and stunt femoral neck. The Swedish registry bears this out and says higher reoperation rate post hemi or total arthroplasty with conventional lengths if reused, and is important to bridge the previous defects and the holes in the femur. They also mentioned dislocation risk with the type of approach, but that is a topic for a different day, whether the posterior approach has any more dislocation than a direct lateral if the good capsular repair is done. And they have also added on that this is a procedure to be done by experienced surgeons only. So this is a couple of examples of the same. An 82-year-old lady with a reverse IT type of fracture, mixed with a DCS, progressive failure over the next 3 to 4 months. Partial weight bearing was advised, but there was no way that this 82-year-old could do that. So I suspect she was full weight bearing in any case. And we had to go down and do a conventional total hip replacement in this because she was very lucid, but porotic, and she's back on her feet and walking very well now. At 2 years, with using a single stick, more so for her imbalance secondary to a mild stroke earlier. Another reverse intertrochanteric fracture. Now, this 84-year-old gentleman happens to be a father of a physician colleague of mine and was managing quite well at home. He was operated, saved elsewhere, and had a 7-hour long operation. At the end of it, this was the x-ray that my colleague showed it to me. This was the image at post-op films. 2 months post-op, patient was still non-weight bearing, only being allowed bed to chair transfer. 3 months post-op, still non-weight bearing, against the implant failing and cutting out. But note the fracture line developing just proximal to the proximal most screw hole in the DCS plate. This is when he presented to us. 4 months post-op with severe pain, no active SLR, unable to walk, and simply fed up. There was no way that I would be offering him a repeat osteosynthesis. So the only option here was to allow to give him a hip replacement, which would be able to get him up and going. Now, because his acetabulum was not very violated, my option was to go for a bipolar here. Oh, this is, as I said, often for a heavy arthroplasty in view of the age and the intact acetabulum. Two levels of problems were anticipated, one at the proximal fracture and secondly at the shaft fracture. So we went in for a long distal fixing implant with distal locking holes. Removing the broken screws, as you can imagine, was a bit of a challenge as well. Luckily, his bone was not terribly porotic because of him being a male, I suspect. So this is what we use, a reef prosthesis for reconstruction with distal locking as well. It was in hard work, intraoperative, implant removal, broken screw set, deep tissue samples for culture, always to be sent to rule out any occult infections. And version was adjusted for a best stability using the reef implant. The abductor repair was done performed using the ethmoid. 18 months post-surgery, walking quite comfortably without pain. Range of movement also very satisfactory. Please note the amount of bone that has formed in the proximal femur. This is an HA-coated implant, which is an osteoconductive implant. So look at the amount of bone that has formed, and the smile of this gentleman says it all. And you can see how comfortably he is. He's now 88 and doing very well. Another case where the wrong implant again was used. This was no way a case for a DHS. This lady again refused osteosynthesis, saying she wanted one predictable surgery. So we've converted her into a long stem bipolar hemiarthroplasty and an 18 months complete union at the reverse IT high subtrox site as well. So once you restore the biomechanics, everything else follows in the right direction. Another patient with a wrong choice of implant, this time who had a Wagner bipolar hemiarthroplasty. So, but this is not something which I want to leave you with the message that it is all very well. No, the things can go wrong. There are significant complications, one of them being dislocation, periprosthetic fractures, medical comorbidities, and durability bearings with constrained options and standby should be available at all times. So what happens if you do a if you have a heavy arthroplasty? Well, unfortunately, you have to go down again and convert it. Are you adding on a acetabular cup? This today I might do a dual mobility for these ladies. Because now I'm more and more convinced that a weak soft tissue envelope is not the best option to leave them with only a simple bipolar. So in conclusion, salvage arthroplasty is a far more complex version of a primary arthroplasty and not certainly for the faint-hearted or the inexperienced. It is a common meeting ground for the trauma and the arthroplasty surgeon. Get it right the first time is the crucial mantra for all proximal hip fractures. Meticulous planning and execution are the major keys to success. Newer implant options offer better results, and I'm sure we will be seeing more dual mobilities being done in this patient group to help them get up and rehab faster. Soft tissue reconstruction is as important as implants, and results are gratifying and well worth the efforts. Thank you very much for your time. Right. So that brings us to the end of our talks here. Anybody having any questions? Any questions from the audience? Vikram or anybody?
Sir, I think we have one question from Dr. Dhaval Desai in the chat box. Maybe if I can wait for that, is double cementing almost certainly cow cement reaction?
Pardon?
Is double cementing almost certainly cow cement reaction?
Yeah, Atul, are you there? Can you take that question?
I didn't get it. What does he mean by double cementing?
He's saying whenever there is a revision scenario, if you're using cement in cement technique, does that create the same reaction as in a primary scenario?
No, I don't think so. I don't think so. Because anyway, you're not going to be in contact with the host bone. So I don't think it should create that much of a reaction. I don't think there's enough literature on that. But theoretically, I feel it should not create the same kind of reaction. What about your views?
I agree. On the chat, I kind of replied to Dhaval saying that I don't think it would cause, because it's not exposed like that. So cement in cement technique is for people who are not aware. If you have a CPT stem or a Exeter stem, which and you want to revise it, you can just knock that stem out, inject fresh cement, and then push that back in. That is less likely to cause any embolism, or is not known. At least I have not come across any paper or even a case report describing to that effect.
Okay, Atul, if I may ask, in your opinion, is there any place for a cemented long stem?
What I'm saying is,
a person has an IT fixed with a four-hole DHS, conventional 135 degrees. Mm-hmm. And for some reason, it cuts out or fails, poor reduction, porosis, lack of medical management, whatever. Would you have any hesitation in offering a cemented revision here? Or, I mean, do you always offer uncemented? Do you anytime offer a cemented revision for these patients? I'm not talking about the cost.
I understand. There was osteoporosis may be the only reason why sometimes I would do a cemented hip. But I agree, fully agree with you that proximal cementing may not be good at all. So, and it's very difficult to cement those hips. You know, the proximal cement is always not as well pressurized. But if the femur is really very, very porotic, I would think of it. But I agree with you. I also don't do so much of long stem use.
So can I generalize and say there is no role for a long cemented stem in any part of hip arthroplasty?
I think so.
Yeah, Vivek, your views?
Yeah, I agree. I would not. I would go for a diaphyseal holding stem of some kind to kind of in that scenario. I don't see any role there.
Yes, I agree with you.
So just for the audience, that the uncemented long stems used to be very prohibitively expensive, but we've got few good Indian options in the market now. So you can really use those implants without increasing the cost too much. That was one of the refrain from a lot of patients. People, a lot of surgeons saying, oh, uncemented stems are very expensive. That is the option. So that is the only reason I have seen some x-rays when somebody has used a long cemented revision stem after a failed DHS and some cement coming out through those holes, which really is not going to last. I mean, unless the patient is very old and will last for 2 or 3 years. Right. Any other questions, Vikram, in the box?
No, sir, but maybe I would request the doctors who are attending, so you can maybe, we have time for question answers, so you can maybe type in the Q&A box, or maybe you can raise your hand. We can also take few questions.
Yeah, please. We are happy to do that. Anybody's keen to ask anything?
Girish, if I may, the question that I had was, in a scenario where you have revised, you have shown a few cases where the GT is kind of flying off a bit, and you've used a bipolar. In such a scenario, obviously, you are concerned about stability, and you don't want to kind of use a THR in those cases because of the abductor efficiency.
Right.
In such a scenario, now would you opt to do a dual mobility THR?
Oh yes, of course. It's a very well. I see that the abductors are repaired meticulously, but still, it is something which, if I am not happy with my repair, I will have a very, very low threshold, Vivek, to go on to a dual mobility system. I am very, very honest that that dual mobility system for me has the best role in these salvage operations, because they have a higher risk of instability because of poor soft tissues. So I think that's a very, very important addition to our armamentarium.
Okay, so Dhaval had asked a question. Dhaval Desai had asked a question.
Yeah, sure.
Where you decide to do a THR, how do you address the GT? Do you use any of, so I kind of had replied to him saying that I use one of these hook plates, which you can kind of, with cables, around. So have you any experience of using those with a THR scenario in that case?
No. I so far, touch wood, I've done pretty well with reconstructing it with the use of Ethibond. in a similar scenario that you would otherwise do a Charlie type of wiring. You see, to transverse the thing and to and across the trochanter. As I said, a couple of my colleagues that I have spoken to also have started using fiber wire. But no, I have not put plates because I think it becomes too bulky. And if you can, the flying trochanter is not an issue. It is the abductor continuity. So if you see a lot of Charlie's original X-rays after his trochanteric osteotomy, there were a few flying trochanters, but they were not unstable hips. So if the abductor mechanism is in continuity, bony healing may not be the most vital thing. That's what my personal
But you are still concerned about the abductor, because in Chandri's yes. cases, there is a primary scenario where he has done it, and then you have several months, years. By the time it flies off, you have enough scar tissue for it to be
yes.
the abductor to be strong, and therefore yes, the hip doesn't become unstable.
Absolutely. So that's why
my talk, you are, I said you are doing a hemi.
Yeah. So as I said, now in scenarios now I will lean towards dual mobility because it gives me more stability. That's the most great, important great. Determinant. So I will be honest that the abductor repair is the most critical part of a satisfactory outcome in anything right. post a failed fixation salvage.
Correct. Okay. I there was another question which was asked to me directly. So I'll kind of sum up that question as well. Do in the 55 to 65 age group, why do I opt for a dual mobility? So I might have come across a little more aggressively on to argue for my case for a dual mobility. I still, in 70 to 80% of my cases, still do a THR, a standard THR in the 55-65 age group. The only reason why I use a dual mobility in a smaller percentage is if they are from the rural areas who want to kind of come and squat or sit cross-legged, and there are some who come, then I would rather use a dual mobility. But otherwise, I'm still doing a standard THR for most young 55 to 65 age group. The only concern why I'm not going for dual mobility is I am not sure whether I can give the same long-term survival with the dual mobility in the present scenario as a THR would. So as of now, that is my position. So I apologize for creating any confusion if there is any. I still use a THR in the young and the fit. I don't know what your thoughts are, guys.
Yeah. So far, dual mobility utilized for a very specific selected group of patients. Primary scenario, if they are not the ones who will comply with instructions for a primary total hip and merit a replacement. And secondly, for those who've got compromised proximal soft tissues, i.e. post failed reconstruction, when you're not happy with the abductor mass or reconstruction that you have on table, I would think DM is a good option in those. That is my personal take. Yeah.
Even some patients with, say, polio, Vivek, you have shown a case of polio. I agree. In polio, I think that's the answer.
Yeah, anything neuromuscular, Atul. Anything neuromuscular, of course, dual mobility. But yes, I don't think I'll be brave enough to let them sit cross-legged. Atul, will you make them sit cross-legged?
No, I don't allow that.
No.
Because
Vivek, that's out. That's out. You're giving our guys a very, very utopian scenario. Making them squat and sit cross-legged is a bit risky, no?
And our patients are known to take things for granted. If you tell them
at the end of the day, I have the data that in CCOT and JCOT we have published. So mine and Dr. Sanjay Agarwala's combined, we now have close to 250 plus cases. So wherever anybody wants to kind of sit cross-legged or wants to squat, we are allowing them, like those large head metal on metal days. We are just allowing them. So what I'm saying is that we need to kind of, obviously it's a very small group of patients who would still, if you allow them, how many 70-year-olds squat anyway? So there is a small group. So the active group, I still allow them, but I don't know. I'm still kind of putting my fingers crossed to see what the long-term outcome from this is.
Vivek, the wear rates may increase, I feel, because of that.
Possibly, that's a concern, isn't it, similar for total knees.
You can they can sit cross-legged, but they wear out much faster, I suppose.
Yes
again, yeah, we don't have data because the don't know, do some data, some large pans out whether and interesting.
So we'll come out with our, so now we have a 3 years data. So by the 10-year follow-up, we'll follow up these patients. But most of the elderly, I mean, you look at it, there's a large percentage where you kind of die every year. So that is right. Why you cannot come out with it. But the young and fit will kind of come out with the data, because, hopefully 10 years.
For some strange reason, the Indians love sitting cross-legged, even on the bed.
Yes.
So, you know, they just love it. So, you know, that's a little concern. So, I don't know. I do that hard edge. So, for me, sitting cross-legged is complete anathema because they'll just dislocate it. So, for all you posterior guys, maybe it's a safer option. A thing to be thought about, whether it's approach-dependent post-op instruction or not.
Plus the wear rates may just increase. Even if you had if I use a large head in a ceramic hip, I would really not allow them that.
Yes.
No, because dislocation is not the only worry. Long-term wear and effect of that is a big worry.
Right. Okay, great. Anybody else having any burning questions before we call it a day? It's 9:30 and Saturday night.
Dhanani, I think there is Dr. Dhaval want to maybe ask something, so we can maybe have something from him, his queries. So I'm just unmuting.
Yes.
Dr. Dhaval, you can unmute and then maybe you can put in your query. Dr. Dhaval, you can just unmute and you can then maybe.
Dr. Dhaval is one of the leading teachers of the AO group. So it's interesting to see what he wants to say.
Dr. Dhaval, you can unmute and then maybe you can unmute from your device and then you can put in your...
Am I unmuted now?
Yes.
Yes, Dr. Desai.
Okay, welcome. Good evening. Nice talks and nice this thing. So, two things. One is are there any implant extraction challenges that you face and you have a plan B for that? And what about infection? So, subclinical infection with these revisions?
Are you asking? Okay. So implant removal options, problems, I said no, because the broken screws are a big, big disaster. So you have to have all the armamentarium of removing those broken screws. And so implants, luckily, half of them have cutouts. Those who have got knowledge, and in all these cases, it worry. So we have to meticulously rule it out with blood investigations, etc. And I do send deep tissue samples on table. So far, I've not had anybody come back with a florid infection. But yeah, it is a theoretical possibility.
Girish, off late, I've started using Stimulan with vancomycin locally, when I'm doing post-traumatic arthroplasties. What is your view on that?
Yes. If patient affording, yes, good option. But sometimes Stimulan can stimulate a reaction which can, have some oozing from the wound. So you don't really know whether there's an infection or whether this is a Stimulan reaction. I've had one patient, so I'm a little skeptical. Sounds theoretically very good, but it has got that drawback.
Okay, yeah.
Dhaval is happy with what he's told him. Right, Vikram, I think we should call it a day, Baba. It's 9:40.
Yes,
time
sir.
To join the family. Yep.
Yes. Yeah. Maybe closing comments from you all speakers, sir. Maybe for you want to say.
Yeah. So I would say thank you very much to Johnson & Johnson for giving us this platform. And thank you very much to Atul and Vivek for such excellent talks on topics which have still not got the jury out. So there are still some people doubting. There are some surgeons in this city of Bombay, if I say, would never do a cemented stem for heavy arthroplasty. Never.
Yeah. Never.
Because they've burned their hands, they've had patients dying on table. Well, there are others who, like me, sitting on the fence, kabhi ye, kabhi to kabhi wo. So, Atul clarified it, so hopefully we'll think it more clearly. And Vivek gave us a very big insight into what the future holds and what we can incorporate currently into scenarios where the instability is a big worry. So thank you very much, and great to have you all along, and hope to catch up sometime soon.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Thanks. Good night.
Bye. Good night.
Bye. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all audience for joining today. Good night, sir.
Bye. Good night.
Recording stopped.